So today we're going to explore value, shading, and tone, which are pretty much the same thing. And we're going to start by having a reference photo of an apple, and we're going to draw this apple three times using three different techniques. So before we start drawing, we're going to sketch it out. I'm using a sketch and wash pencil, and I have a vinyl eraser that is a white vinyl eraser that's kind of soft, and this is a very soft pencil. So I'm going to hold my pencil to the side as I've done before, so my brain understands that I am sketching and not drawing, and I am stopping myself from making hard definitive lines because I'm just trying to get a general idea for the shape first. So each of these three apples are going to fit, and I'm going to do two smaller shapes at the top and one larger apple at the bottom. And so I'm starting off with lightly sketched circles because this is a circular shape, and then I'm going to carve away at that to find the shape of the apple inside. So first thing I want to do is find about where that stem projects from the apple. So it's about in the center. I'm just going to make kind of an indication that it's slightly curved. I'm using the side of my pencil again, so I'm not making any dark definitive lines. And then I'm going to round out the tops of my apples and kind of taper in the bottom of the apple so I have the base different than the top. And again, I'm just being real general as I'm doing this, holding my pencil to the side so I can find those general shapes before I start carving out the details. So now I can go back, indicate the stem and the leaf. I have my paper taped down so it doesn't shift too much, as well as my reference photo. So I now have a leaf and a stem on all three apples, okay? So the top apple, I'm gonna use the technique of hatch marks. This will be crosshatch, and this will be cross contour, okay? So the cross contour is gonna take the most amount of time, and we'll talk more about that. So let's start up here with the hatch. So as I'm looking back and forth from my reference photo to my drawing, I'm trying to find where areas are dark, light, and middle gray. And I'm going to try to plan out where the highlights are so I don't have to spend so much time erasing later. So I can see that if this is this shape here, and I have my stem which curves up slightly to the right, and I'm kind of tightening up the grip on my pencil because I am transitioning from the sketch to the drawing. And as I'm drawing, I want to look to see where the darkest area is. And so at the base of my apple, it is the darkest. Hatch marks, as we have discussed, are parallel lines, and depending on how far apart they are versus how close they are, you can get very dark values to lighter values. As well as black. So I'm going to try to keep all of my lines running parallel and on the same diagonal. So the areas that are lighter, I'm not going to press as hard and I'm not going to use as many lines. The areas that are darker, such as the base, I'm going to shade quite hard, and because this pencil is soft, it's going to give me a beautiful, rich, true black. And I'm transitioning from this dark to a middle value. There are areas in here that are a little bit lighter, but not quite white, so I'm not going to add as much pressure, and I'm also going to leave some of those areas. So I've got a lighter area here. I'm going to do the same thing there as well. And my eye is jumping back and forth from my reference photo to my drawing, so I'm trying to get it as close as possible just using hatch lines on this first drawing. Center is dark. This is a gray here. I'm not going to worry too much about the veins, just kind of understanding that this side of the leaf is darker than that side. So I'll use more lines here, casting a little bit of a shadow onto the apple itself. But again, trying to keep my lines parallel. Center that apple is quite dark. Got a lighter edge here on the outside, transitioning to a darker base. And you'll see with this pencil that you'll create a dark side to your hand, but it washes off. So I haven't used my eraser at all. At this point, I could use it. I could go back to kind of lift some of these highlights so we understand where the light is reflecting. If I want to clean up the edge of that leaf, I can do that. Gently brush away the shavings. I can clean up this edge here. And I'm going to move on to my crosshatch. I'm pretty much doing the same thing with my crosshatch, except for my lines are going to run perpendicular. They can also run up and down and side to side. So crosshatching doesn't just mean one moving perpendicular. You can layer until you have multiple hatch marks. So let's try to clean up this sketch, turn it into a drawing here. Think about the angle of that leaf again. I think I had it over a little too far to the left here. Pull in that base. Looks like we've got three dips in the bottom of our apple. One in the middle, another one over to the right. So find that highlight and that soft highlight to the right, and I'm going to start again with my hatch marks that are running parallel. And now I'm right-handed. Those of you that are left-handed, you can switch this around. Your lines might go the other direction. You will know what's more comfortable for yourself. I can't tell you which way you're more comfortable orienting. That's just a personal preference. So I'm going to go and push those blacks far. We tend to be afraid to push our blacks because we're afraid to make a mistake. We're more comfortable in that middle gray than we are with our true blacks. But our blacks is what create depth and form. And when your value is developed, you can get a three-dimensional form opposed to a flat form. So I'm going to bring that down a little bit, noticing that that highlight is not as strong as I think. So now that I am developing my darks at the base, again, I'm applying more pressure with my pencil. My lines are still running parallel with one another, but I'm going to start to intersect them. So obviously this apple, because I have twice as many lines, is going to be twice as dark. At this point, I'm just using perpendicular lines, but I'm developing more form than even this first one. And by layering, I'm creating depth. Because my pencil is quite soft, I can also sharpen it at this point, give it a couple turns so I can really get in to those areas that I want to set back. All right, so let's move on to our cross contour, because we could spend forever on these details. So I'm going to clean up my drawing a little bit, get some of those details. Again, the angle of my leaf, trying to look back and forth. And these are about the same size, so it makes it a little bit easier. These are a little bit smaller. When it's the same size as your reference, easier for your eye to jump back and forth and make those comparisons. Still holding my pencil kind of lightly, loosely. This is going to help me make those final decisions before adding pressure. Okay, so we're familiar with a globe and longitude and latitude. And that's kind of how we want to see this cross contour approach. So if I imagine that everything is being pulled into the center of my apple where the stem is emerging, and all of these lines are wrapping around. Cross contour drawings define the form as well as the value. So I'm trying to think of the most descriptive lines to show me how round this apple is. And the longitude and the latitude of a globe, when we're talking about a sphere, help us see the form. Okay, but I'm going to do the same thing with these lines. These are also cross-hatching lines, but these cross-hatching lines are defining even more than my second apple. So as I am defining, I can even create little ellipses around my stem to give it the illusion of form going back and forth as I can with my leaf. And so this is where I'm going to take into account the veining of the leaf, and I can show even more detail stem is much rounder here than it appears in either of these two apples. And if it almost feels like these lines are pulling down into the center of the apple, I'm creating even more form. And it's a slight curve as it wraps around. And as these overlap, it's becoming rich black and creating the illusion of three-dimensional object. I can use my eraser to find those highlights because I haven't drawn too hard. Is the tops, the highlight I have here, I even have a shadow. I can go and define the veining of my leaf, applying less pressure on the right hand side because I understand that that is where the light is hitting. And this drawing is much more time consuming and creating a realism that is lacking in these two. So take your time defining the contours as those lines wrap around the form. Because this is the center, that line almost becomes straight up and down. And this is a semi-symmetrical object. So these lines will radiate around the left and the right, converging in the center. Side. A lot of times you can get big sections covered by using the side of your pencil opposed to the point. Kind of soften those edges so we've got a nice transition from my dark to a light. The more I look at this apple, the more details I see. Drawing over my eraser shaving. Trying to push this as far as I can to feel like we're really seeing the form. Thank you. Take your time, create that realism. The more time you invest in your drawing, the more gratifying it'll be. And every time you draw, you're learning something new. Even those of us that have been drawing for years. Every single time you draw, you learn. And you get better. It's like storing up your pennies in a piggy bank. Every little penny counts. Every little drawing counts. And every drawing makes you richer. When you're finished and you feel satisfied and it's the roundest, juiciest apple that you've ever seen, you can go back, clean up your edges, final details, and call it a day.